Good afternoon, everyone. Thanks to everyone that has tuned in to my channel. As I promised, here is my New Madrid earthquake video, part 3. Maybe it goes without saying, but if you haven't seen my first two New Madrid earthquake videos, you may want to go watch those first. To give you an update, I received a copy of the renowned James Lull Penick book in the mail just this week. It was a used copy mailed to me from a bookseller in St. Louis, Missouri. Unfortunately, the book smells terrible. Maybe it was stored in a wet basement. I've been reading the book with my arms fully extended. Once again, the 1811-1812 New Madrid earthquakes were a series of earthquakes beginning with an initial earthquake on December 16, 1811. They remain the most powerful earthquakes to hit the contiguous United States east of the Rocky Mountains in recorded history. In my previous videos, I speculated on unnatural events causing the New Madrid earthquake. I also speculated on the ruinous state of American cities as evidenced by early photography. Could there be a parallel between the New Madrid event and the state of American cities? Recently, I also made similarly related earthquake videos, the Caracas 1812 quake and the Thomas Prince account on various quakes. There are some fascinating similarities and patterns amongst the accounts of the quakes, ringing of church bells, sulfurous vapor, and loud noises, not unlike cannons or artillery. I could probably spend more time summarizing the details of all these quakes, but hopefully, if you've seen my previous videos, you already have some idea. And almost like a crime scene, where all the clues are present, the cause of the earthquakes remain a mystery. This is a common theme amongst the authors who have written about the New Madrid earthquake of 1811-1812. The cause of the New Madrid earthquake remains a mystery. For example, looking at the 1912 Myron L. Fuller account called the New Madrid earthquake, Fuller exhaustively covers the New Madrid earthquake in all its details. Eyewitness accounts, previous quakes in the Mississippi Valley, fissures, and even atmospheric conditions. One look at the index page in his book shows this. Yet, Myron Fuller leaves the reader with few concluding remarks as to the cause of the New Madrid earthquake. And, in the same way, reading the last chapter of James Lull Penick's New Madrid book, the reader is left unsatisfied as to what caused the New Madrid earthquake. The last chapter in Penick's book is entitled, A Question on Causation. Okay, so now I am arriving at the topic I will discuss today. What caused the New Madrid earthquake of 1811-1812? What does Fuller say? What does Penick say? And what do I say? A closer look at subterranean fires, electric fluid, and telluric currents. Of all the reading I have done lately about the New Madrid quake, one detail is jumping out at me. Subterranean fires, electric fluid, and telluric currents. And actually, I run the risk of looking foolish by suggesting the above, but that's a risk I'm willing to take. Let's explore the possibility. Without many more words, was the New Madrid earthquake caused by subterranean fires, electric fluid, and telluric currents? All of the literature on the New Madrid earthquakes contain overwhelming details and descriptions. My thoughts are, what if I just gathered all the electric fluid references into a single video? So that's what I'm doing here. I have a greater suspicion in mind about the electrical nature of these quakes, but it's a work in progress. For now, I'm just going to gather and present some electrical references. Alright, let's just get into it. Here is the fastest way to get you acquainted with what I'm talking about. Let's go back and look at the work of Alexander von Humboldt, who had so much to say about the Caracas earthquake. And I will rely on a quote from a book that I previously mentioned in the Caracas quake video, and it's found on page 6. From the beginning of 1811 till 1813, a vast extent of the earth, limited by the meridian of the Azores, the valley of the Ohio, the cordilleras of New Grenada, the coasts of Venezuela, and the volcanoes of the smaller West India Islands, has been shaken almost at the same time by commotions, which may be attributed to subterraneous fires. As I covered in my Caracas earthquake video, Humboldt was an important figure who extensively chronicled and described Latin America. In Humboldt's large volume of work, he makes considerable effort to link various earthquakes and volcanoes of the same era, and he makes effort to demonstrate how these catastrophes were related. Humboldt's concept of subterranean fires made a considerable impact on various attempts to understand earthquakes and volcanoes. As will become more apparent, subterranean fires were a significant detail in the narrative surrounding the New Madrid earthquakes. I'm going to prove this to you by presenting the two accounts. The first is from Myron L. Fuller, and the second is from James Lal Pennick. So starting with Myron L. Fuller's New Madrid earthquake book, 1912, at the end of his book, Fuller devotes less than 4 pages to writing as to the cause of the New Madrid earthquake. This can be found on pages 102 to 105. Please see a link in the description below for a complete copy of Fuller's book. Fuller further reduces the ultimate cause of the quake to a single paragraph of writing. In my opinion, Fuller's conclusion as to the ultimate cause of the New Madrid earthquake is a bit wishy-washy. You may wish to pause and read this for yourself. What I am interested in is what Fuller has to say regarding electricity and the earthquakes. On page 102, Fuller is generally saying that explanations relating to the New Madrid earthquake tend towards volcanic theory, rather than seismological explanations such as doming, warping, and fault lines. Fuller even suggests that New Madrid stories about the emission of sparks and similar phenomena are related to ideas about volcanoes. It's a bit technical to re-explain what Fuller says, but there is a reference made to Cape Girardeau and the hot springs of Ouachita and subterranean fires blowing and bellowing out of these mountains. He touches upon the combustion of coal beds in that area. Were there active volcanoes in this area? That was actually something I looked at in my last New Madrid earthquake video. However, moving on, I wish I could summarize what Fuller says on page 103, because it says some remarkable things about electricity, gas, coal, and the New Madrid quake. Unfortunately, it's too complicated to summarize, so I will just read it into the video. Fuller is actually making reference to the Bringier account. Speaking of the New Madrid shock, Bringier says, "Several authors have asserted that earthquakes proceed from volcanic causes, but although this may be often true, the earthquake alluded to here must have had another cause. Time perhaps will give us some better ideas as to the origin of these extraordinary phenomena. It is probable that they are produced in different instances by different causes, and that electricity is one of them. The shocks of the earthquake of Louisiana in 1812 produced emotions and sensations much resembling those of a strong galvanic battery. It will perhaps be pertinent to observe that this earthquake took place after a long succession of very heavy rains, such as had never been seen before in that country." Fuller goes on, "Nuttall," which is another account of the earthquake, "Nuttall, on the other hand, refers the earthquake to the decomposition of beds of lignite or wood coal saturated near the level of the river and filled with pyrite. In the light of our present knowledge of earthquake causes in general and of the non-volcanic nature of any of the adjacent regions, the theory of volcanic origin can be dismissed without further consideration. Electricity can likewise be ruled out as a cause, although certain electrical and magnetic phenomena appear to be associated with most great earthquakes. Aside from the absence of records, geologic or other, of any extensive expulsion of gas, we have the testimony of all eyewitnesses to the effect that the expulsion of gases and the associated water was the result and not the cause of the disturbance." Once again, Fuller's explanation is a little bit indecisive. He seems to say that electricity is not the cause of the New Madrid quake, but volcanic-type electricity has been the cause of other quakes. For those watching, I'll let you be the judge as to what Fuller means. To be fair, Fuller does go on to suggest attenuation from the underground Paleozoic rocks as the result of the great expanse of the earthquake, although these aren't Fuller's exact words. There are some other quotes in Fuller's book regarding the electricity, or rather electrical fluid. Fuller references the popular New Madrid earthquake account by Samuel Latham Mitchell from 1815. And, without digressing too much, Samuel Latham Mitchell has an article about him on Wikipedia. A notable mention is that Samuel Latham Mitchell endorsed the building of the Erie Canal, but that's a whole nother story. Without being too confusing, Fuller references Mitchell, who references a Dr. McBride of Pineville, South Carolina, who remarks on the electric fluid involved in the New Madrid earthquake. Comments are particular to 3 points, and I should mention this is found on page 30, I believe, of Fuller's book. The 3 points are as follows. 1. An uncharacteristic absence of thunderstorms during the year 1811. 2. Red clouds which darkened the water immediately preceding the New Madrid quake. 3. Unusual wintertime thunder. Moving on to page 45 and 46 of Fuller's account addresses the various New Madrid shocks, which, as noted in my previous videos, featured darkness, sulfurous vapor, and odors. Simultaneously, light flashes also appeared. Fuller is once again referencing the Samuel Latham Mitchell account from 1815. And once again, I'm just going to read the quote, as it's difficult to summarize. Light flashes and glows. The phenomena of what may be termed light flashes and glows seem so improbable that they would be dismissed from consideration but for the considerable number of localities from which they were reported. Dillard, in speaking of the shocks, not especially the first one, says, "There issued no burning flames but flashes such as would result from an explosion of gas or from passing of electricity from cloud to cloud." Lewis F. Linn, United States Senator, in a letter to the chairman of the Committee on Commerce, says, "The shock was accompanied ever by anon by flashes of electricity, rendering the darkness doubly terrible." Another evidently somewhat excited observer near New Madrid thought he saw many sparks of fire emitted from the earth. At St. Louis, gleams of flashes of light were frequently visible around the horizon in different directions, generally ascending from the earth. In Livingston County, according to Mr. Riddick, the atmosphere previous to the shock of February 8 was remarkably luminous, objects being visible for considerable distance, although there was no moon. On this occasion, the brightness was general and did not proceed from any point or spot in the heavens. It was broad and expanded, reaching from the zenith on every side toward the horizon. It exhibited no flashes nor coruscations, but as long as it lasted, was a diffused illumination of the atmosphere on all sides. At Bardstown, there are reported to have been frequent lights during the commotions. At Knoxville, Tennessee, at the end of the first shock, 2 flashes of light at intervals of about a minute, very much like distant lightning, were observed. Farther cast, in North Carolina, there were reported 3 large extraordinary fires in the air. One appeared in the easterly direction, one in the north, and one in the south. The continuance was several hours, their size as large as a house on fire. The motion of the blaze was quite visible, but no sparks appeared. At Savannah, Georgia, the first shock is said to have been preceded by a flash of light. And just my own thoughts, but keep in mind that lightning in December is rare, which is when the New Madrid earthquakes started in 1811. In Fuller's book, after the lengthy quote which I've just read, Fuller goes on to relate this aforementioned quotes, to a 1907 Mexican earthquake, which was a recent phenomena at the time of Fuller's own writing. And for the sake of being brief, comments are made as to how lights appeared in the sky during the Mexican earthquake of 1907, similar to the aurora borealis, or rather, to the northern lights. Anyway, this concludes the material I wanted to cover from Fuller's account. Now I will be presenting what James Lull Pennock's book says regarding the cause of the New Madrid earthquake. Reading the last chapter of Pennock's New Madrid book, the reader is left a little unsatisfied as to what caused the New Madrid earthquake. The last chapter in his book is entitled A Question on Causation, but it still speculates differing ideas, particularly seismological explanation. I will only focus on his remarks regarding subterranean fires, electric fluid, and telluric currents. Speaking of which, Page 128 of Penick's book starts with a really compelling quote. He is actually citing the words of Humboldt, who I have mentioned before. This chapter begins, "As the mass of the people are seldom able to rise to general views and are consequently always disposed to ascribe great phenomena to local, telluric, and atmospheric processes, wherever the shaking of the earth is continued for a long time, fears of the eruptions of a new volcano are awakened." Alexander von Humboldt, 1849. Actually, since I have just read it, I will let you know, this quote itself is what caused me to put this video together. When I read this, I immediately Googled telluric current, and I was even immediately met with more of Alexander Humboldt's writing. As I speak, I haven't had the time yet to catch up and read this material from Humboldt. At the moment, I am a little overwhelmed with avenues for exploration on the subject of telluric current. But getting back to Penick's book, I'm going to give point form notes just so I can get through it. On page 128, Penick once again briefly mentions the 1811 comet. On page 129, he mentions from the Thomas Nuttall account, Thomas Nuttall, a botanist that believed that the shocks were caused by the decomposition of a vast bed of lignite or wood coal under the surface of the earth, so he covers that. And then he covers William Lay Pierce, who suggested shortly after the earthquakes happened that underground steam might have been the cause of the earthquake. The Louisiana Gazette of the time speculated on volcanoes and internal fires, and there was some talk of Ontario, Canada being an extinct volcano. On page 132, John Clark Edwards from Asheville, North Carolina, and his letter, which you might recall from my previous New Madrid earthquake video, is redescribed, which features flashes of light emitting from mountains. Okay, then on page 133 to 135, okay, now I'm going to just read what is contained on these pages. It speaks in a way that I cannot sum up easily, and Penick remarks a lot about subterranean fires and electric fluid. So just in his own words, I'll begin reading. Page 133. "Wandering Indians claimed to have discovered a volcano on the headwaters of the Arkansas River. Indians had long been the source of rumors of smoking mountains located somewhere in the West. A widely accepted physical theory of the time held that the true origin of both volcanoes and earthquakes was the electric fluid. Earthquakes were known to travel very fast. One writer estimated that the shock of 1755 had spread over an area of 4 million square miles in a little over an hour. The cause of this speed was traced to electricity. There was one blind prediction that the earthquakes would be found to have originated in the Cordillera de los Andes. The electrical impulse which may be given by a volcano of the Andes would reach us in the course of an hour, or sooner, in proportion to the quantity of electric fluid affected by the contact. News of the destruction of Caracas made such conjectures seem almost prophetic." Page 134. "Earthquakes did not depend on volcanoes at all, and were known to occur independently. That subtle fluid was the efficient cause of both and just about everything else." Period. "From the mid-19th century, electricity had evolved from a frivolous curiosity into the greatest force in the cosmos. Comte Georges-Louis Leclerc de Buffon regarded it as the cause of all volcanic eruptions. Jean-Baptiste de Monet, Chevalier de Lamarck, believed it was the prime mover behind organic evolution. The founder of Methodism, John Wesley, called it the soul of the universe. This fluid everywhere pervaded the interior of the earth," in the words of the editor of the St. Louis, Louisiana Gazette. His source was the third edition of Encyclopedia Britannica, 1797, the last printed in America before the earthquakes, which attributed everything that happened on heaven and earth to its presence. Not only did electricity account for all terrestrial phenomena, such as rain, snow, hail, lightning, and winds, but through the power of the magnet it guided the planets on their course through the heavens. Whether we look to the heavens above or to the earth beneath, we can scarce perceive anything that is not acted upon and in a manner perfectly subjected to the operations of this wonderful fluid, I guess electric fluid. Inevitably, it was believed to be the cause of earthquakes, And although there were a few doubters, especially after the investigations that surrounded the Italian shocks at Calabria in 1783, the electrical fluid theory still held the field in that useful compendium, the Britannica. In America, with a few eccentric exceptions such as Nuttall, almost everyone with any pretensions to education turned to the electric fluid for an ultimate explanation of the earthquakes. The theory, simply put, was this. The subtle fluid was everywhere in the earth, but in evenly balanced quantities, and there was a balance also between the amount in the earth and in the atmosphere. It was kept from accumulating in the earth in unhealthy quantities by passing into the atmosphere as vapor, water being the most common conductor. If for some reason it was prevented from escaping in this way, it would necessarily find another outlet. It might discharge itself through a volcano or leap into the nearest ocean. But if a surplus of fluid accumulated at any point and none of these outlets were available to it, then the most terrible consequences ensued, and it flew against every obstacle with inconceivable violence. It would break out through those places that offered the least resistance. Water would leap out of the wells. Dry wells were long associated with the aftermath of earthquakes. Trees, houses, steeples, and other structures, because of their height, relatively less oppressed by the weight of the atmosphere, would suddenly and horribly be transformed into escape hatches for pent-up forces. Then indeed would the voice of nature speak in thunder. Okay, folks, thank you for listening. I am going to stop this video short. Hopefully it presents the New Madrid earthquakes with regard to subterranean fires, electric fluid, and telluric currents. I have more to say on this subject, but I will leave it to an additional video. So yes, thank you to my viewers. I hope you enjoyed this. Please expect a New Madrid earthquake video, part 4. In my next video, I intend to draw some conclusions about the electric nature of the New Madrid earthquake of 1811-1812. Thanks again.